besieges people with hatred. Anger at migrants or refugees, homophobia, violence against children, girls and women have unacceptably permeated too many minds. Eradicating hatred and enhancing diversity can start only by the sincere commitment of community and faith leaders everywhere through inclusive dialogue. While we focus today on the important role of faith-based organizations in promoting understanding, it is also important to harness the creativity, energy, and the tolerant ideology of youth. Our efforts for peace and solidarity must focus on younger people and the bedrock universal human rights. Today, more than 80% of the people living on Earth are affiliated with a religious group. This number reveals the immense mobilizing potential of religion. Indeed, in many countries, spiritual beliefs and religion are main drivers for cultural values, for social inclusion, for political engagement and economic prosperity. How do we tap into this potential as we forge ahead in our quest to achieve the SDGs for all people? How can we turn the dialogue between faiths into something practical? In short, how can we go from dialogue to implementation? Part of the answer, I believe, lies within the realm of faith-based organizations and their efforts towards sustainable development. The United Nations is a secular organization, and it is in this secularism that we have a safe space for all religions. All of us here share a common objective, a future of dignity, of prosperity, and peace on a healthy planet. 3 years ago, this common objective has been agreed upon by the international community in the form of the Transformational and Universal 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. This agenda is remarkable in many ways, including the way by which it was created. It was shaped by what is often considered the largest consultation process in the history of the United Nations. Faith-based organizations were very much a part of this process of conceptualizing this agenda. Today, 3 years later, it is the time to accelerate the implementation of this agenda, and faith-based organizations continue to play a critical role in addressing the needs of those left behind. After all, today's development challenges are complex and greater than any one government or organization to solve. Multilateralism is under siege, and the human rights agenda is losing traction. Our world is strained by intolerance, by discrimination, and the rise of populist nationalist policies. We must create the space to leverage partnerships, including with faith-based organizations, and it is here where faith-based organizations have a critical role to play. The core values of all faiths are largely in line with the 2030 agenda. This is true whether they are Christian, Buddhist, Hindu, Jewish, Muslim, or any other major faith. To be true to the spirit of the 2030 agenda, we must focus our capacity building efforts on those furthest behind. However, reaching these parts of society is a challenge in itself. Faith-based organizations and religious groupings, on the other hand, often have the outreach and presence in the remotest parts of the world and are operating at the community level. Their activities are integrated into communities and close to the grassroots. They are trusted, they have large networks, and this makes them long-lasting and sustainable. They often have the data, for example, based on the communities they serve. Much better data than is available with many national statistical systems. There are several examples where faith-based organizations and the United Nations are working together. One of them is the Plan of Action to Preventing Violent Extremism that was launched 3 years ago. Another one is the United Nations Task Force on Religion and Development, whose members work with hundreds of faith-based partners at national, at regional, and at global levels. There are numerous ways in which faith-based organizations can power the implementation of the agenda for the world we want. This year's discussions, in particular, will focus on the phenomena of global migration, especially with reference to the historic UN Global Compact for safe, orderly, and regular migration, which was adopted in Marrakesh this past December. We want to attest that faith and faith-based organizations remain critical players in the development of local, national, and international migration policy. As far as global solidarity and welcoming the stranger is concerned, I would like to quote from the Bible and the Upanishads. Leviticus, and I quote, "The alien who resides with you shall be to you as the citizen among you. You shall love the alien as yourself, for you were aliens in the land of Egypt." From the Mahapanishads, from Hinduism, I quote, "This person is my relative, and that person is a stranger, says the small-minded one. For one who knows the truth, the whole world is a family." Let me end by referring to my own Indian identity from the land which gave birth to four major religions: Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, and Sikhism. And along with these were all major religions coexist: Muslims, Christians, Jews, Zoroastrians. Harmony works best in my own life experience, I have found, where it takes the form of interfaith action for the poorest and the most destitute. Words alone are not enough. And I quote from Mahatma Gandhi, who said, "There are people in the world so hungry that God cannot appear to them except in the form of bread." With that, I end my opening remarks. I hope that we continue this annual global interfaith dialogue, and more than that, in its wake, find concrete ways to implement effective programs that serve sustainable development on a regular basis. I thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Seth. Much appreciated. Now we will move to the panel itself, and I will have the pleasure of inviting to the presidium over here the permanent representative of Canada, Ambassador McCartney, the permanent representative of Azerbaijan, Ambassador Sadikov, the permanent representative of Singapore, Ambassador Kuk-Jong Fu, the permanent representative, the permanent observer of the Holy See, Archbishop Yurkovic, the permanent observer of the Order of Malta, Ambassador Vetu, and the deputy permanent observer of the OIC, Ambassador Kane. If I may invite you to come to this side, please.